Thank you to Booker T. Washington High School for hosting this special presentation of the Nasher Sculpture Center's 360 Speaker Series. I'm Curator of Education, Anna Smith, and today I'm pleased to introduce artist Nathan Carter. My colleagues and I have a private joke that in many museums, the real F word is fun. Well, today I'm pleased to say that Nathan Carter has come to the Nasher and dropped a giant fun bomb on our corner gallery. His exhibition, bearing the awesome title, The DRAMASTICS, a punk rock victory twister in Texas, is an explosion of color, band merch, and tiny film sets centered around the artist's fictional all-female punk band, The DRAMASTICS. I want to let Nathan give you the full story of The DRAMASTICS, but I do think it's important to note that the legendary rock group is meant to have formed right here at Booker T. Washington High School. I also think it's important to note that the Nasher is just down Flora Street and admission is free for Booker T students. So please feel super welcome to come down in the next few weeks to see this totally insane installation for yourselves. And at the risk of sounding like an adult trying to be cool, it is very Instagram worthy. Nathan Carter was born in Dallas, Texas, and has had solo exhibitions at such venues as Mura Guadalajara, One Star Press Paris, the Blaffer Art Museum Houston, and the Museum of Contemporary Art Denver. He has also participated in a number of group exhibitions, including Alexander Calder in Contemporary Art, Form, Balance, Joy, which traveled to the Nasher in 2012, Art from Elsewhere, International Contemporary Art from UK Galleries at the Gallery of Modern Art Glasgow in 2014, and also Art from Elsewhere 2016 at the Bristol Museum and Art Gallery. So everyone, I hope you have as much fun hearing from Nathan as we have had hosting him at the Nasher. So please join me now to welcome Nathan Carter.
Hi, how are you? Thanks for coming. Thanks for that, Anna. And thanks to the Nasher and Saluna. And I'm really happy to be here at Booker T. Washington. Let me see if I can get an image to come up on my screen. There we go. Is it on the screen? Okay. There we go. Okay. I live in Brooklyn, New York. I always keep my friends around so I have someone to talk to. I walk wherever I go to. But sometimes I take the subway. This is my neighborhood. It's a kind of typical brownstone neighborhood. It's called Carroll Gardens. In my neighborhood, like when I moved there, the people who would own the businesses around where I live would usually be named for the thing that they did, like Mike Pizza or Joey Rice Balls, or in this case, Jerry Bagels. This is when Jerry Bagels died. It's that kind of place. I take the subway a lot. I love taking the subway. Subway is like one of my, it's like a studio in a way. I get a lot of like good thinking and drawing done on the subway. But it's important when you take the subway to not run down the stairs. This image comes back later. I use it for something. Yeah, there's the subway. I'm always taking these pictures. I just love it when it comes into the station and kind of, it's like a big rumbling, noisy metal thing. Here's just some views. This is like when I'm walking to my studio in the morning. I go through a kind of heavy industrial area called Gowanus. This is, I have to cross a bridge over a canal. And these two boats are, they're squatted by this all-women's anarchist bicycle gang. And I'm always like, just they're always kind of there, or were, doing things. And I was always really curious, like, what goes on those boats? You know, but I couldn't really just kind of go there. I mean, it's like I said, all-women's anarchist bicycle gang. There's the famous cyclone. There's me. Okay, so before you go out, it's important to have a healthy breakfast. Or this kind of breakfast. It's also important to have a really, really good pair of shoes for walking. New York is a walking city. And it's important to like have things with you when you go out. Like, you know, your pockets are full of stuff just in case you need a bottle rocket or like an old flip phone. This really dates me actually with that There's, you see the antenna on the top of the phone? And there's a cassette, too. That's a, you know. Oh, this dates me, too, because this is when people used to use tokens to get on the subway. And at the Museum of Transportation in New York, they had this amazing exhibit of slugs used to avoid payment of fares. And I thought it looked like a display of subway pirates, each one of these little objects. They're like shaved coins and amusement park tokens. And okay. I'm going to play a little. This is like the soundtrack for where I live. This is a song by Gangstar. It's called The Place That We Dwell. And it's about Brooklyn. So you'll hear, it's a kind of like, this song is like a landscape guide to Brooklyn.
New York, New York is where we live, and we're thorough. Never taking shorts, cause Brooklyn's the borough. East of Uptown to Queens and the Bronx. Long Island and Jersey get as fly as they want. But I must tell ya, where we rest is no joke. So let me break it down to sections for your slow folks. Fort Greene, Bed-Stuy, Flatbush, Brownsville, Brown Heights in East New York, or be down till Medina takes respect for the styles we bring. Cause in Brooklyn, we be into our own thing. Atlantic terminals, Red Hook, Bushwick. Come to Brooklyn front, and you'll get mush quick. We ain't just known for flipping and turning our bodies, but also for the take no bullshit hardies. On the subject of blackness, well, let me share this. Brooklyn is the home for cultural awareness. So in all fairness, you could never compare this. Some good, some bad, little hope for the weak. Dangerous streets and Coney Island Beach. All this included when you go for a tour. Some can get scandalous and outright raw. When you step correct and watch where you move. We pay dues, so we ain't trying to lose here in Brooklyn.
Okay, you get the idea. I live in New York, but I grew up in Boston. And this kind of sums up the fear and anxiety of what it's like to grow up in a place like Boston. And if you're a little bit different, that's what happens. This is me in high school. I'm 18 years old. This is taken right before we went to like a really, really nice Thanksgiving dinner at a restaurant. My mom was so happy, I was really angry. Take it in. Okay. Okay, so when I was in high school, I found this recently, like maybe, like a few months ago, I was looking through some boxes from that time, and I found all of my high school notebooks. And I laid them out on this table, and I thought, oh, this is like fucking amazing. Like this, they really are just, I mean, I affected every surface of this thing. And then I opened them, and they were completely empty. Like, I mean, there were some vague attempts at taking notes and like, you know, some bits and pieces in there, but this is kind of like clearly what I was interested in doing is I wanted to make these things look a certain way, and I did. I also played with toys like this. And these. Okay, so fast forward, I live in New York, I have a studio, it looks like this. Dan, that's Emily. I really, really, so it, yeah, right when I started, it looked like this, okay? But what I really wanted was I wanted it to look like this. This is Hunter Thompson, who's a writer, wrote Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas, among other things, Hell's Angels. This is his office. It's like a kitchen. And what you can't see in this photograph is that on either sides of the two ends of these counters are low refrigerators. And one is full of vodka, and the other one is full of chocolate things. And then there's also across the room, there's this huge wall of televisions. And like, this was from a long time ago, so there were like fax machines and telephones. And that's how that was like his internet, this like big wall of electronics. And he would spend a lot of time talking on the phones and drinking and eating chocolate and playing with guns. And then he shot himself. I pick up things on the way to the studio, and I make things like this sometimes. These are gifts for friends. There's a lot of welding that happens and like steel work. I make sculpture. I weld too, but only in Paris when it's snowing. And okay, and I like to have dinners at my studio. That's a thing. It's like a social place, you know. It's not just like, well, that's work too, but it's I like to have people over. And then there's the cleanup, always. But I kind of, you know, I love taking these pictures of the like, carnage after the party. This is my grandfather, Albert Swindon, who was one of the kind of very, very, well, yeah, like in the first wave of artists moving to New York City from Europe and calling themselves American abstract artists. And he made paintings that looked like this, and I kind of grew up with these around the house. And so when I would see a image like this, I'd think, wow, that looks, I kind of know that image, but it's kind of like one step more real. Or Richard Scarry. I don't know if any of you ever had these books when you were growing up. These, I like these because you open them up and it kind of like tells the whole story of a scene. And I always like these images where your eye can travel around and kind of like just be entertained by watching a thing. Maps like this, or this, or this. This tells the story of how Godzilla breathes fire, clearly. I bet you never knew that. All right, here's Willem de Kooning. So this is, before I kind of like get into showing images of the work, this is a thing about abstraction. Because this is how I learned about abstraction, is that I saw a film of him talking, and he said this thing about like that abstraction to him was like a slipping glimpse of like a multi-layered experience and then trying to create that slipping glimpse. So he told the story about leaving his studio and seeing a woman in a red dress crossing the street, and then a blue sports car drove past really fast, and he'd be really wound up and excited about it, and he'd run back to his studio and paint this. And is it funny? Yeah. All right. Okay. Okay, here's this. Okay, that's his abstraction, right? This is my abstraction. Is Watt didn't invent this, but okay, so here's Flavor Flav and Chuck D from Public Enemy wearing Minor Threat t-shirts, and they have a producer named Hank Shockley who invented this thing called the 4 a.m. sound for their early recordings. And what it was they would go out in the city at night and put up their flyers and their posters. And they would always have a very large radio with them. So at 4 a.m., they're walking around downtown Manhattan, and they're like posting their posters up, like wheat pasting them on the walls. And then all of a sudden, like this guy would show up with his radio, and he would be doing posters. That's LL Cool J. He was a musician. And then like these guys would show up with their radios, and all of a sudden you'd have this like all these dudes with their radios and all mixing, and like, and then these fools would show up, and like it would be car alarms going off and people yelling like shut up, and then these guys fuck you, like no we're not, and flyers and music and everything like that. And the Public Enemy's producer just said, you know, like that there's something about that sound, that is the sound of the city at night, all of that, like that, the din of that, and that, and he made music that sounded like that. So that is kind of like my idea of abstraction. Or you see a Richard Serra piece being carried down the street and you put on Black Sabbath on the radio. Okay, here's another version of abstraction, or a story. I like stories. Okay, so the airplane turns around, takes off. Control tower says, like, you know, runway 2 right, have a nice day. Plane flies out into the night. The pilot, wait, this is the pilot. Okay, this pilot says, like, thank you and good night, and, you know, turning heading 512. Oscar Kilo Delta. And then this guy picks up the signal, and then it gets kind of mixed up with the Jamaican radio station, and the wires get crossed, and then there's this thing, and the police show up and arrest the wrong cat. Do you see the cat under the car? That's the cat that they were looking for. And then this guy got stuck in the elevator. They relayed the message, to be a little Alpenhorn. This guy, sign language, and he sneezed. And this guy showed up, the Hamburglar, and this dog got married, and this guy jumped over the fence, and then there's this note. Okay. And then the plane landed okay. All right. Serious now, no more joking around. Now the art. Okay, so I make art. This is a sculpture. This, a lot of this work, early work I'm going to show, is about communicating and maps and electronic transmissions and antennas. And I thought this would look like if you could see a text message leaving your phone and watching it float across the room. It might look like this. These are thought of as like pirate radio stations. This piece is actually here. It's in a hospital in Dallas, not because it got hurt, but just because it's like displayed. I can't remember the name of that hospital, and I should, and I'm sorry, but if you get hurt, you might see it. This is a kind of a handmade radio antenna, so you could like move it to pick up a signal. Best installation of one of these ever. Okay, so remember the little bits that I would pick up off the street? They're used for these. This is, to me, this is like a map. It's like a subway map, and all of those colorful things are like episodic points of interest along the way. Here's a paper version with coins and foil. It was around this, when I made this drawing, I thought, oh, I could make jewelry. And sometimes they're calm and quiet. These are actually just really new. These are just from like hot off the press. This is in Houston. This is the first outdoor piece I ever did. Sometimes I make things that hang inside. This is in Mexico in a diamond mall. Okay, music. This is where it starts to get good. I got an offer to make a book by a French art book publishing artist book company, and I had to kind of think, what was I going to do? So I thought, okay, I'll make these flyers that I used to make when, like, in high school, I had a band, and we would, like, kind of make these handmade cut and paste flyers. I thought, I'll make a whole book of these. And then I was, like, posing with my bass guitar, and then my friend Matthew Rone, who's on the drums, I got him to pose behind a drum kit, and that's his friend Ben, who plays guitar. And then all of a sudden, we thought, like, maybe let's make some music. And we hadn't done this for a long time. And so we started kind of like, we just like made the music that we listened to in high school, which was like punk rock, hardcore music. And then we started to play these shows and make sets for the background. Like the set was a really important thing to make a kind of a graphic. And then handmade spray paint stencil t-shirts, lots of t-shirts. And we would just give these away at the show. And then more flyers. See, there's the don't slip, trip or fall, stay in the ball. Subway, he's pushing me down the steps. And then, like, we wouldn't play in clubs at all, only art galleries, like, that would let us do this. And so, when you went to an opening, it looked like this, instead of, like, people bored standing around trying to talk to each other. And it was, like, you know, fun. Okay, I'm gonna play you just like, so you get, you know, kind of what I'm talking about. Here's one of, this is us doing a cover. The blonde kind of singer guy, his girlfriend convinced him to quit the band so they could do a duet, and which never went anywhere. And so Matthew and I decided to become briefly an industrial metal band together, and we played in Berlin. That's the only place we played. Of course, it had to be Berlin. So we went and did that. And then I did this music festival with like junior high kids in Paris. And it was like all these bands, and all I did was make the backdrop, and I had to introduce the bands at the thing. And I mean, they sounded like, you can imagine, except this band is really good, and they're huge in France right now. They're called The Tears with three E's. or ours. That's me saying, like, here's the band. And then I would like, oh, the singer had this, his mother had just bought him this $600 leather jacket. And he's like, can you do that stencil on my jacket? And I said, yes. And I taught them how to make stencils. And then his mother was so pissed about this. But it was great. And like all their friends showed up. And it's like, this was like their first rock concert. I mean, they'll never forget this, you know? Okay, so then after we were an industrial metal band, we were this. And and we didn't, as you could, there's no instruments, really. And we would just like jump around until these costumes fell apart. And we would yell a lot. Okay, now, I'm going to switch audio. And I don't know if this audio is going to work, but I'll try. And we'll see. I really hope it works. Okay, don't laugh. Yeah. Okay. So, right, we did this for a while. This is us. And then like we went for a really long time without doing one of these performances. And then Matthew had been kind of, he has this friend named Tony Cox, who was a pro skateboarder. And Tony is a performer in like every cell in his body. And he wanted to have it be like his performance, like he wanted like the Tony show, and he has this alter ego called Ron Littles, and he wanted to rap and have us play drum machines in the background, so we kind of changed to this, and I'll play you.
Wow, that's really impressive, actually.
And I'm not asking for
any money. I'm not asking for any money.
Are you sure?
Okay, just to give you a sense of, okay, now that's him like on a normal day, and then when we perform, it's like this is us like in our hotel room right before we played our first kind of concert in this form at the UCLA at the Hammer Museum in Los Angeles.
What do you mean I can't get back into my room? The hotel door is locked and I need to do it. I don't know if this is gonna work out this time because I'm having to do it for a second time.
Okay. So then when we get on stage, he just does these things, because he was a skateboarder, so he could like do these unbelievable things with his body that like, you know, that and yoga. And then it's like he's like the queeniest burlesque, dirty South rapper that you, I mean. And then we just play the drums, really. This is our first show in New York, and he dressed up only in onion bags. Okay. You get the idea. All right. Then things got a little dark, and I kind of became really interested in, yeah, just this. I don't even have to explain this, because this, you know this. Chernobyl. Mad Max. Australia. Blade Runner. And I looking at all that stuff, and then suddenly I made these, like, out of the blue, one day. This kind of just happened. And I'd never, ever in my life drawn the figure. And I was kind of like, whoa, what's this? And also, you see there's an amplifier there. And I would probably, like, play guitar to these characters. And I was so, this is weird, but I was so kind of ashamed that I had made these drawings. Like, I was like, I can never show these. So I collaged cityscapes over them. And you can kind of see them there. If you look carefully at the collages, you see the figures still. They're kind of like, they're there. And then they all went to the gallery where I show in Manhattan called K.C. Kaplan Gallery, which is in Chelsea on the West Side Highway, right on the water. And then this happened. And then they all got destroyed. And this is the gallery, like, the day after the hurricane. There was, like, five feet of water in this gallery. And after that, I started making storm paintings. And I really was, like, I loved the way these looked, but I wanted to tell stories. Like, and then I kind of started thinking about all this music that I listened to. And when I was in high school, I would stare at these photographs of my favorite musicians and just, like, inhale the, you know, just lie back and kind of, like, look at these pictures and listen to this music and just dream, like, what would this be like? That was Black Flag, Minor Threat, The Bad Brains, The Clash. I love the way all the equipment looks. Angus Young, Lemmy from Motorhead, wearing short shorts. The Clash again. David Bowie. Gorgeous. Motley Crue. Guns N' Roses. Slayer. Slayer's a big one. Metallica's big too. But Slayers, I got to meet this guy once, which was amazing. So my mom didn't let me go see Slayer when I was in high school, and so I had to make a drawing of what I thought the stage looked like. And when I met this guy, I showed him this drawing, and I said, this was my fantasy of what your stage looked like. And he was like, that was my fantasy too. And the Van Halen. Again, there's just something about these photographs of all this equipment that I just was like, look at all these shapes and things, and it's loud, and like, these people kind of look sort of cool. And there's like a gas mask on the drum kit and a fire extinguisher. Don't know why, but there it is. Fugazi. The Sex Pistols. Okay, so the one thing that all of these photographs have in common, right? It's like, they're all dudes being, like, there's Steve Jones being a guy, right? But I was also listening to this other kind of music, right? And I'm going to put on, so you know. So, like I said, I grew up in Boston, and if you did anything out of the ordinary, you were gonna get, like, beat. And so I really wanted to be in one of those kind of bands that I just showed you. So I'm gonna go back really quick and go through this super fast. Bikini Kill, that was the music, that was Rebel Girl. This is The Runaways again. Ari Yup, one of the runaway members, a famous one. Pauline Black from The Selector. L7. This is actually a really big one for me. I didn't really realize this until recently, how kind of, like, I really wanted to be in this band. Leslie Gore, You Don't Own Me. Xene from X. Sister Nancy. I think that's Vivian from The Slits. There's Ari Up again. She was also in The Slits. Typical girl. Polystyrene from The X-Ray Specs. There's Madonna, Freshening Her Pits. Deborah Harry again. And these are like, I think, in the foreground, it's the singer of the Runaways, and I think one of those is her sister, and then there's somebody else. That's the Valley. So I thought, like, if I couldn't be in one of those bands with this body, I'll just invent a band, right? So I'm gonna play you really quick. So I made a film that's about 29 minutes long. It's like a puppet show. And it was the first time I've ever made a film. So what I'm gonna show you is just like 2 minute, like really brief, kind of like just super brief thing of, you know, greatest hits from the film.
This is a dance hall. Get off the floor, boy. You better learn how to dance.
Do you get it?
Wait, I forgot to tell you. The film takes place, it starts on the roof of Booker T. Washington High School. I forgot, it's really important to mention. At a high school graduation rooftop party. Okay? Oh no, sorry.
This is a dance hall! Get off the floor, boy! You better learn how to dance!
Do you get it? We're gonna start a band.
It's an alternative tuning.
Oh, okay, yeah, right.
Yeah. Melancholy. Did you just eat a bug?
My name is Calamity.
Blah.
Whoa. Are you okay?
Girls can't play rock and roll music.
If you say that one more time, I'm gonna sit on you.
A girl band.
Perfect. Well, now that we have our mascot, we're ready for our next show.
Hey, watch it. Easy back on the wing flaps. Watch your attitude. Altitude.
I heard the next show is in Paris. Ooh la la.
We love you American women and your pointless enthusiasm.
I can't believe she said it's bad timing. What a cold-hearted person.
Bonne nuit, mademoiselle.
Hi there. I like your music. I wish I could play the viola with a baguette.
It's a party, it's a party, it's a dirty, dirty party, it's a rage, it's a stage, I'm gonna rage, rage, rage! It's a kegger, it's a kegger, it's a molly, molly kegger, it's a celebration!
You get the idea. If you want to see the whole thing, just walk over to the Nasher Sculpture Center and you just go in and say, I'm from Booker T, and I'm here to see this thing. And it's playing in the corner gallery that they give to delinquents. And I'm just gonna talk a little bit about the development of the film. And this is like the first thing I did. I think I'd made these drawings again with these kind of figures in them, and I was like, I'd like very early, kind of not knowing how to draw the figure. Like I was all grown up, and I'd been making abstract art my whole life, and like not maybe without, I don't know. Yeah, couldn't do it. I was afraid to draw faces and hands and feet, but I liked drawing the clothing. And I loved these drawings, but I thought they needed, again, like more of a story. Like, well, what were they doing? What do they say? There's kind of modeled off people like Anne Bonnet, who was a pirate, and in order, like after she pirated you, she would like rip open her shirt so you knew you'd been pirated by a woman. And then I was like really, really like kind of reinvestigating these graphic novels that I used to read called Love and Rockets, which are about teenagers from Los Angeles, from the East Side, which means you're from Mexico. And it was all about the music that they made and just like I loved the way these looked. And I thought, I've got to do something about this. Okay, so while I'm starting to develop the characters for the film, I also start making things that I had like never really made before, or I'd never really thought of as like being art. And I think this is this really, really important thing about being an artist, that you just have to make things all the time, and it doesn't matter what it is, if it's a poem, a song, a piece of writing, a drawing, a print, a sculpture. It doesn't, just make things, and it all comes through your filter. My studio started to get full of all this funny things. The color palette changed. It got really flamboyant. I made t-shirts, tote bags, more t-shirts. These things I call fascinators. Sunglasses out of paper, dresses, Halloween costumes. He's a land shark. Vinyl sticker murals. It's the same slide, sorry. I don't know, table sculptures, more fascinators. There they are again. Drawings. Jackets. These are the jackets that I made as a kind of a gift for these women who helped me make my film. And then I would keep like playing guitar at the work, trying to write songs for the film. Portraits, purses. There's Nikki de St. Fall. I was kind of looking at things like this too, so I'm making and looking. I think these are like Lillian Bassman photos for Harper's Bazaar. There's Suzanne Farrell, the ballet dancer. Skirts, more paper fascinators. Okay, so when I say fascinator, you know, this is what I'm talking about, these little sculptures that certain people wear on their heads. And I was like, oh, I can do that too. Buns. I like buns. Especially this kind. Same tote bag, more drawings, jackets, sewing patches on my pants, small sculptures, scarves, big scarves, party dresses, skirts, coloring my shirts, more of those, rings, more party dresses, there's a ring, hats, dresses, still playing guitar at my sculptures, shades, shoes. And then I started making these drawings suddenly of like, maybe these are the band members. And then I made this drawing. Wait, how am I doing on time? I'm okay? What does that mean? Great, I'll be done. I thought this, they have to have this crazy energy. So I was like, I'll make a drawing like this. And I thought, I'm never gonna show this to anybody, so it's fine. And then they start looking like this. So this is a good point, like I'm really loose now. And then I get like this, and I thought, oh wow, here's the band. And maybe they have names. And then I got really tight. Some good stuff happened, but mostly the energy went away. Then I made some fairies. And then I kind of like took a photo of what they might look like if they're on stage, like with a little flashlight pointed at it or something like that. Starting to develop. I'm showing you this because I think it's nice, like if you make art, to kind of see that things don't just come from outer space. Like you try things, they don't work, and it's great. Happy accidents, mistakes. really crazy. That's the drummer. And then this is like sort of the very first, like it was kind of a big change from there to there. But this is what she looks like inside. And that's, so this is Calamity. Is Trinity here? No, okay. I was gonna try to get a Booker T alumni to come and help me talk about this, who she helped me develop these characters. We would sit and talk about each one and what would the bass player be named and what the drummer like and what do they eat and what kind of music do they listen to. And we would make these lists, and then I would start to learn how to draw eyes. And like thinking about, I'd never thought about bat wing eyeliner. Well, I thought about it, I just didn't really respond to, and make something out of it. And again, like with development, I mean, things have to start somewhere. Like who knew that Darth Vader originally had a rainbow colored lightsaber? And just making drawings of like what would happen in the film. And trying lighting and building sets. There's this is supposed to be the roof of your school with a DJ and a keg. And then this is kind of where I arrived, right? This is like rehearsal space. Okay, so the singer is named Molly Blowout, as in like blowout hair, as in like Molly, as you know, and then like blowout, like a party, like a Molly party. She's the star, clearly. Her best friend at school is named Crimson Ivy, and she like sweeps all the ivies, and is about to go off to Yale. But she wants to have a kind of a visceral experience in the summer between the end of high school and the beginning and college. So they say, let's start a band, and they get Melancholy, who has no friends, and she's kind of based off this character from Breakfast Club called Ally Sheedy, who would like pick bugs out of her hair and eat them. And then she has some issues and has a bag that she carries with her that's like Marge Simpson's hair, like it's got everything in it, like from hummus and pills and just like hair straighteners that she sits on. And then she's always the one that gets yelled at in the film. And she doesn't really, like, she's kind of polite and doesn't really respond so much. So she just thinks, like, skull. Okay, then there's Calamity. She's kind of one of my favorites. She is from raised in a metal scrapyard. She's like a junkyard dog, in a way. And she has fangs and red eyes. And she is either, like fighting or fucking or eating or throwing up, or like she's just kind of a very physical person. And she's based off Animal from the Muppets. And then they had to have like a rival band, right? So I had to invent the guys too, who are mean. They're called the Cream and Demons. And then here's like the French potential boyfriend who plays the viola with the baguette. This is Handsome Dan, and he's a recording studio engineer who is kind of taken by the drummer, let's say, in the film. This is how they get around. Like, most bands drive around in a van, and they fly in a flying machine. And what I mean by flying machine is like this. Like, it's a flying machine. And their pilots are drunk. And there's this amazing show called Absolutely Fabulous, and these two characters kind of come from that show. That the idea of giving, like, them an airplane to fly around. And this is the kind of fuselage of the plane that's where they deal with turbulence and pills. And okay, so this is how the thing was made. It's not stop motion, because I didn't want to go home every day and say, like, I did 2 seconds. Like, I wanted to film it like a puppet show, like fun and fast. And so I had this amazing collection of like these women that are pretty close to the age of, well, like maybe 4 years difference at this time to the age of the band members. And the one on the lower right is Trinity Lewis, who went to school here. And they also, let's see when I get to this part, right? So this is how I'm filming. I'm just using a camera, like just whatever lights I had on hand, Christmas lights, very, very like low tech, because I didn't know what I was doing. And here's the recording engineer. Here's a party in Paris. there's the Desert Generator show. And my studio starts to get like really interesting looking. Like it's getting to that look that I wanted. And then when we would film, what they wanted in return, well, they got these, they wanted those jackets, but they also would ask for a giant bowl of guacamole, quesadillas, and a handle of Tito's. And then that was like, and that's how, this is how we worked. And it was like every week, at night, we'd be kind of like filming. And I would kind of be playing the director and like figuring out how to use my camera. Like if you ask me what f-stop is or ISO, I have no idea. That's Danielle. There's Paris. So it's filmed just like you know, like I said, the Muppets. Like it's kind of, you know, people operating things and their hands are just out of the frame of the camera, but sometimes their hands pop up and that's okay. Then they would decide to stop working. And then this would happen. Always like singing and all these things. And we would take all these great photographs of like just kind of jumping around. And it was this amazing energy. And of course, the next day, never cleaning. They don't clean anything ever. That was my job. Okay, then we did the voices for the film. So we wrote a script and then like, I made up this story, and then we would kind of like change the lines a little bit and think like it was nice to having them around so I could say, well, what would they say, you know? And Danielle with the glasses does the voice of the one who sweeps all the ivies because she sounds like she's read 5,000 books. And then Trinity does this lead singer because she knows about music and being a lead singer. And this is Laura. This is the woman who cuts my hair. She is the drummer voice because she sounds like a punk rock truck driver. And this is my friend Patricia, who's a painter who does the voice of melancholy because she has this extremely deep, like really deep Detroit accent voice. And then like these would be some of the guys. And we would just, you know, like record. And it was usually the outtakes, that not even the lines that they were reading, but like the stuff that they would say in between drinks. Okay, we made the music for the film. I wrote all the music, they sang, it was really fun. I actually feel like I made the entire thing as an excuse to make the music. So when I first showed the film at the Museum of Contemporary Art in Denver, they asked me if we would play the music live for the film, and I said yes. And then I suddenly had to put a band together, and I was like, I'm old, and I was like, but I really wanted to do it so badly, so I kind of like got the band together, and it's like, the band is actually like three dads, and then these like three 25-year-old women who are like, hey, let's go on tour, no responsibilities, let's do it, and I'm like, no, and so like last night, we screened the film at the Nasher Sculpture Center, and then right as soon as the film ends, we tear down the screen and like rip a quick punk rock set. Tonight we're playing at the Grapevine Bar in Dallas, Texas. There you go. So I'm making the same posters. Then our next show is in Detroit at a Museum of Contemporary Art in Detroit. And this is kind of what it sounds like when we play. All right, so this is the end, right? Sometimes you feel like this. So it's important to eat a healthy breakfast or a lunch. When you go to a party, really go to a party, okay? Don't go to like half parties. Do this. Always draw on the go. There's Tehran, just in case you were wondering. It's not the devil there. Don't take any shit. Have a clue. Hold tight. Teach the youth. Ride a unicycle. fitness. This is our fitness, sorry. Stay fit, follow your obsessions, and don't forget to L-O-V-E. Thank you very much. Yeah, so are we done? Yeah. What was that? Two questions. Anybody got a question? Okay.
Yo, Nathan.
Yes, hi.
So I was just wondering, like, you know how you were like, I can't be in a all-girl punk band because of my, like, current middle-aged white man body.
Yeah.
But, like, don't you think that, like,
well, I mean, I'm in one, though.
Yeah.
I am in one. Yeah. Last night I wore a pink cape, satin pink cape.
And I looked beautiful. That's why you made the movie instead of just, like, being in the band or whatever.
Oh, that's why I made the film. Yeah. It was an excuse in the back of my mind. I was like, maybe I get to go on stage and play music.
That's what you're saying.
Yeah.
But, like, don't you think that in the earlier parts of your career, if you were, like, a chick, you would have been overly sexualized for, like, your little dancing around in your costume thing?
Yep.
And then you wouldn't have, like, you would have gotten discouraged, maybe, and not made the things that you've made at this point.
Totally true. Totally true. Yeah. You know, I think when I think back to, like, when I first started making and showing art professionally, I was terrified. And I did what I thought I was supposed to do. And at a certain point, I just learned how to play. And I thought, I wish that when I was your age, I wish that someone had told me it's okay.
I'm also wondering about the physics of the drummer's pants. Like, how does such low-rise pants stay up without a belt?
I don't know. They're just low. She wears them low.
All right, that's all I have.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. One more? Yes. Okay.
Okay, so the guy who wears the only onion bags, that's a lot of onion bags. Did he eat all of the onions?
No. No, when he lives upstate in New York, actually in the woods, but when he comes down to New York, he stays in Chinatown. So he would have found them on the street with all the other trash that's in Chinatown, like just tons of like food.
So he didn't even like buy them. He just found onion bags.
Totally.
Enough to make an entire outfit.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
That's like a lot of onions.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay, that's all.
Okay. Is that it? I think there was one. No? Come on. Okay. Yes, one.
Do you have any like social media we can follow?
I am on Instagram. I am Hello Brooklyn.
Hello Brooklyn.
Hello Brooklyn. All one word, lowercase, no caps. Hello Brooklyn. I got that one. That it's amazing. Yeah. I love it. The last time I saw a talk here, it was like two people using impenetrable art language talking about European conceptual art. And I was sitting way up at the top because I had to leave early, and I could see it was like a wall of cell phones, like a sea. Like every student was on their cell phone. I thought that was kind of great. Keep onto those phones. That's like your form of communication. Yes?
Nathan, are you talking about
PRQ? Yeah. Huig. Yeah, yeah, yeah. A giveaway? Yeah. Tell me what to do. Yeah.
We have a giveaway.
Oh, so I'm supposed to do, what am I supposed to do? Okay, 6990767. 699, okay, the last three are 767. Okay. The last three numbers are 699. We might have 577. Yay! Oh, hey. Oh. I mean, they have to go, I think. 574. Right there. Yay. Okay. All right. 705. 573. Hey. Yeah. Okay. 679. Six, five, three. No, sorry. 853. Yay. Okay, last one. 816. I'm old. 816. 816. Nope. Okay. 587. No, 587. 588. It's a five. All right. 681.